So we'll go in accordance with the hands raised. Interns, you can raise your hands. We'll start off with the presentations. First, we have Tanu. You can unmute.
Okay, sir. Sir, basically, I'm not scared the screen.
You can't share your screen.
Sir, it is written host disabled participant screen.
Just a second, just a second.
Okay, sir.
You can share it now.
Okay, sir. So, good evening, everyone. Myself Tanu from AWS Cloud Computing Department. So, today's my presentation is on Project Curriculum Cloud-Based Investment Platform. So, now this is the agenda for my PPT. So, I will be discussing about cloud computing, their services model, and its deployment models. What are the cloud services providers, cloud computing in stock market investment, and what are the main key points of cloud computing in stock marketing investment? After that, I will be discussing about that AWS services for cloud-based stock marketing investment. After, what are the advantages of using AWS for stock marketing investment at the last conclusion? So now before moving to our presentation, first of all, I would like to give you a short story that before cloud computing, we will come nearly around 2005 or nearly 2006. So basically, when we set up our own business before cloud computing, so when we are start up our own business, we have to set up our own infrastructures, and we have to own our servers, and we have to own our hardwares and softwares, and we have to manage ourselves. So these are the challenges faced when we are set up our own business, like invest heavily for our setups, like at that time servers are of huge cost, and we have to invest on our resources like our own software app host, and there is less time to focus on our business. So these are the challenges faced by before cloud computing. Basically, before cloud computing, businesses had to store all their data on their physical servers. This was really expensive and time-consuming, but it was the only option available at that time. So it is required a team of IT professional to manage these resources, which was significant cost for the businesses. So now, how basically cloud computing helped to overcome the challenges before cloud computing? So basically, cloud computing help businesses reduce cost by eliminating the need for the physical servers and the IT staff. So it provides a scalable and flexible infrastructures that can be accessed from anywhere, and which is a great for business which with remote employees. And additionally, basically, cloud computing offers better security and reliability than traditional data storage method. And these are the three main points. Cloud computing is basically, we can compare as like electricity supply. Like we were consuming electricity, we have to pay only that what we use. So we can compare like cloud computing is also the real example for the electricity supply. And here the main point is that somebody else manage these services. We have not to manage. Here we can basically focus on our business. So this is how cloud computing helps. So now, what is cloud computing? Basically, in simple words, we can say that it enables on-demand services like compute, storage, networking, or databases, or migration. So many on-demand services are there which cloud computing providers. And the main point is that we can access through the internet only. And in this, the user is not required to manage these resources. This is the main point that our in cloud computing when we are using. So these are the main features that the cloud computing provide us. like scalability. Basically, scalability meaning that businesses can easily adjust their computing resources to their needs, and it is a pay as you go. So businesses also pay for what they use, and it is flexible that it allows businesses to access their data from anywhere, and it provides security and disaster recovery. And so here the businesses can recover their data in any event of the disaster. So these are the main features of the cloud computing. So these are the cloud services models: IWS, PWS, and SWS. So IWS stands for Infrastructure as a Service. So in this, what we have to do, we have to configure this. Basically, here the example we can take like EC2, AWS. Here we have to manage our data, applications, and compilers, our connections. Here, the cloud computing manage like server, networking, and the virtualization. So now coming to the next cloud services models, which is PaaS, PWS, and it stands for Platform as a Service. So here, it provide a platform, like for example, we can take like MySQL, Oracle. We have to just need to deploy our code. And we have not to configure in this, we have to just deploy. And for example, we can take MySQL. So these are the example of PWS. So now coming to the third, the most important cloud services model, and it is the simplest, SWS, which is stands for Software as a Service. For example, we can take Gmail and the Microsoft Office. Here we have to basically work on our data. Here the application, all the service and all the resources are managed by the cloud computing. So these are the three main cloud services models. So now coming to the cloud deployment models. So there are more, four main cloud deployment models, which are public, private, hybrid, and the community. So in public, basically it is a free available to everyone over the internet. The service are provided by an internal company. So here it is basically a cheap with a high security, and we can easily set up and easily quickly access according to our requirements. Now coming to the second one, which is private. In private, basically, it ensures security and control of sensitive data through private sectors. And it is basically costly as compared to the public cloud deployment models. And it is less fast and flexible in adaptations. Now coming to the hybrid. Hybrid is basically the combination of both public and the private cloud deployment models. Basically, it combined the increase and the security of the private cloud with cost, security, and flexibility of the public cloud. Now coming to the community, it is the fourth one, and it basically manufactures the organization share cloud with other organization with similar interests. So these are the four main cloud deployment models, and these are the only one cloud deployment models. Now coming to the next, these are the popular cloud services providers like Amazon Web Service Cloud, Google Cloud Platform, Microsoft Azure, IBM Cloud. There are so many popular cloud service provider, but these are the main four. And now I will be talking about Amazon Web Service. So cloud computing is stock marketing investment. So basically, cloud computing has in stock marketing industry, it provide investors with access to real-time data and analytics, which is essential for making informed investment decision. And additionally, cloud computing allow investors to access their portfolio from anywhere, which is a great for those who travel frequently. Overall, cloud computing has made stock market investing for more accessible and efficient. So this is how cloud computing and stock marketing investing work. So now these are the main four key components of AWS cloud computing in the stock marketing investment. So what are the algorithm trading engine? Second one is market data adapter, and the third one is exchange or the broker adapter, and the last one is data store. So in algorithm trading engine, what is the main point of this? Basically, it is a solution care. We can take the example like trading strategies are created or the tested and operated here. using historical and the real-time data, managing interaction with other solutions component, and basically it provides users with analytics and reporting capabilities. Now coming to the second one, key components, which is market data adapter. It feeds engines with different data types, such as like a real-time market data, historical price data, and the others. Now coming to the third, which is exchange broker adapters. It manages the interactions with the exchange or the broker, for example, to place or revoke order status and other tasks. And the last main key components of cloud computing in stock marketing is data store. Basically, it provides a durable and secure data and used by algorithm trading engines. Now coming to the next. So basically, AWS offers several services for cloud-based stock marketing investment. So AWS Data Exchange, basically what it provides access to financial data from a variety of sources. Now coming to the second, which is AWS S3. AWS S3 basically stands for Simple Storage Service, and it is an object storage service that can store a large amount of data. Now coming to the third one, which is Amazon Athena, is a service that allows users to query data stored in S3 using standard SQL. Now, AWS Glue is basically a service that can be used to transform and move the data. And the last one is SageMaker, is a machine like a learning service that can be used to build predictive model for stock marketing investment. So these are the main AWS services for cloud-based stock marketing investment. So now, coming to the its advantages of using AWS for stock marketing investment. So it is basically a pay-as-you-go model, which basically it provides no upfront investment in this, and it is a continuous information provided by AWS services, and it is easily accessed and easily available to access the technology. So these are the main advantages of using AWS for stock marketing investment. So this is the conclusion. That the project curriculum cloud-based investment stocking marketing, what do you understand by this? So basically this curriculum covers all the essential topics required for cloud computing developers in a stock marketing investing companies. Here the developers will gain hand-on experience with cloud-based data management and the analysis, and with high frequency trading and with high risk management, machine learning, and the artificial intelligence, cloud-based trading platform infrastructure, security monitoring, and troubleshoot. It helps the developer to be well-equipped to contribute to the company's cloud-based stock marketing investing infrastructure. So this is the conclusion that a project curriculum cloud-based stocking investing happen. So these are the references which I have taken the help from this. So these are the both the links from here. We can go through. So any question, please may ask. So if any queries, here is my email ID. So yeah, thank you.
There was no problem with the presentation. The research was done very well. There's only one thing that I would like to add is that in many of your slides, paragraphs have been mentioned. So just shorten it into bullet points. Even in the conclusion, you've mentioned an entire paragraph, and
yes,
you
sir.
were reading the entire thing. That is something that you have to avoid to do entirely. What you have to do is that you have to just mention bullet points, and then you have to just elaborate on them. Okay, that is pretty
sir.
Much it. Thank you for present.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Then we have Shubhi. You can unmute.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, you're audible.
My screen visible?
It's visible.
Okay.
You can start.
Good evening, sir. Myself, Shubhi Vashne. And today I am going to give a presentation on exploratory data analysis to perform a credit card fraud detection. So the objective of this project is to perform EDA on the given data set, to summarize the key findings from the EDA, and then to visualize them using appropriate charts and graphs. Further, to find any missing values or anomalies or outliers in the data. So let us consider a situation where there is a data analyst from a company XYZ who has been assigned a task to create a credit card fraud detection model. He starts working on his project, skipping an initial and crucial step of exploratory data analysis. So what are the consequences of skipping such an important step? The consequences are his model might be highly inaccurate, as the data set might have highly unbalanced data or missing values, anomalies, outliers. So as a result, it is really, really important for one to perform exploratory data analysis before building or constructing a model. Now, what is the need for an EDA? The need for an EDA is that data understanding. Before working with the data set, one has to be familiar with what are the entries, how many rows and columns, basically data understanding. Further, data cleaning and pre-processing. As we know, that data set may contain all kinds of values, null values or inconsistent data that really needs to be addressed before creating a model or any analysis. Feature selection. So EDA helps us to identify the most relevant features or variables that are likely to have significant impact on the target variable. For example, if I create a model on future location prediction, and in that data set which I'm using for that model, there's a column name as favorite color. That column is not as relevant for that model, and I may skip that while creating my model for better accuracy. Then identifying outliers and anomalies. It is really important to identify the extreme values or unusual patterns which may cause harm to the model. Data visualization. We all know that pictures speak better than words. As a result, the visual data, the graphs, plots are better representation of the data. So EDA is really important. Now, what is the procedure for this task? The procedure for this task is to import the libraries, then data set details, data exploration, detection of missing values, descriptive statistics, data visualization, correlation analysis, outlier detection, hypothesis testing, and then subsampling and scatter plots. After subsampling, I have performed the correlation analysis, outlier detection, hypothesis testing again to compare the results. Now, importing libraries. The libraries which I am using in the project are Pandas, which is an open source Python library mainly used for data manipulation. NumPy, which is open source Python library used for multidimensional arrays and matrices. Matplotlib, which is used for creating various types of static and animated visualization. Seaborn, which provides high level of interface for creating attractive and informative statistical graphics. T-test IND, it is used to perform an independent T-test, which is also known as student T-test, to find the relationship between two independent groups. Then DBScan, which is a popular clustering algorithm, and then standard scaler, which is used to standardize or normalize the features of a data set. Then data set details. The data set I will be using in this project is taken from the Kaggle, and this data set contains transactions made by the credit cards in September 2013 by European cardholders. In this, the transactions occurred in 2 days, and we have the total number of transactions of 284807, out of which 492 are fraud. Data exploration, due to confidentiality issues, one is not provided with original features and more background information. But using PCA reduction, we have converted the features from V1 to V28. And the only features which have not have been transformed with PCA are time and amount. So time contains the seconds between each transaction and the first transaction in the data set. The feature amount is the transaction amount. And class is a response variable, in which 1 stands for fraud and 0 stands for valid transactions. Detection of missing values. The data set we used contains no missing value and is consisted of entirely of numeric data type. It has attributes such as time, transaction amounts, and various numerical values. There was only one binary class variable, which is named as class, which had a value of 1 for fraud and 0 for valid transactions. So here's the data visualization. Before subsampling, I had the number of valid transactions really, really high, and the fraud transactions were really low. After subsampling, I have equal number of valid and fraud transactions. This is correlation analysis. Before subsampling, one can see we have highly negative correlations. The heat map consists of mostly same color, whereas after subsampling, one can see different shades of colors from positive to from 1 to minus 0.75 correlation. Then outlier detection. The question arises, what are outliers? So outliers are data points that deviate significantly from the majority of data points and can provide important insight into the data distribution. For example, let us consider a group of 6 people within an age group of 20 to 25, whereas there are 2 more people join the same group whose age is from 35 to 40. Since they are really out from the majority of the data, from the majority of the people there, they are considered as outliers there. For another example, let us consider this example. There are values 10, 12, 14, 16, and 100. So Q1 is 12, Q3 is 16, and Q2, the median, is 14. IQR is 4, which is obtained by Q3 minus Q1. So the lower threshold is obtained by this formula and it's equal to 6, whereas upper threshold is 22. So the value within this range is considered as valid. And on checking the data set here, we get that this value 100 lies above the upper threshold. Therefore, it is called outlier of this distribution. Hypothesis testing. So hypothesis testing is a statistical method used to make inferences about a population based on a sample of data. For better understanding, let us understand hypothesis testing as when a government wants to know whether their policies are working really well or not, they do not go to 130 crore people individually and ask them whether they are liking the policies or not. They just take a sample of people and they perform their questioning, and the result of that is applied as and then the hypothesis testing is performed, which out of which the combined data is obtained, whether they are really working in the correct direction or not. So in this process, in hypothesis testing, we formulate 2 competing hypotheses about a parameter, and then we use a statistical technique to determine whether there is evidence to support one hypothesis over the other. It is a powerful tool in research and helps researchers make evidence-based decisions. Then subsampling and scatter plots. Since the data set provided to us was highly unbalanced, with having very large number of valid transactions and very low number of fraud transactions, we have to really do subsampling to ensure that we have equal number of valid and fraud transactions to create a better model with a higher accuracy. So what are the steps in subsampling? The steps in subsampling are data collection, then defining subsampling rate, then random selection or regular interval. Now, how random selection or regular interval takes place? If one randomly selects data points from the original data set with the probability equal to subsampling rate, it is random selection. Whereas one can select data points at regular interval too. For example, at an interval of 3. So one can select the data points at an interval of 3, then create a subsampled data set. Now the scatter plot of subsampled data set with reduced features that really showed higher correlation. So I have used PCA reduction as well as TSD reduction. I hope my screen is again visible.
Yeah, it's visible.
Okay. So here I'll make you understand the code of the same project. First, I have imported the libraries. Then I am reading the data set here. Then I have described the data set with how many entries are there for each column. What is the mean? What is the standard deviation? 25% quartile, 50% quartile. Then head, where I have 31 rows and five rows and 31 columns. Then tail, last and the first readings. Then this data set contains 284807 rows with 31 columns. The data type of this data set is all the columns are of float type, with class being an integer type. Then I have performed percentage of, then I find out the percentage of fraudulent transactions, which comes out as 0.17, which is really, really small compared to the size of data set. Then detection of missing values. One can see there are no missing values in the entire data set. I have find out that in class, how many are zero entries and how many are one. Zero stands for valid, which is really high, 2284315, and one for 492. Then the amount, how, with mean, standard, and all. Then data visualization. Here I have plotted out the graph for the distribution of classes, valid and fraud. One can see there are really, really small number of fraud transactions as compared to valid transactions. Then I have performed for the distribution of transaction amount. And one can see there is a large chunk over here as compared to the higher transaction amounts. Correlation analysis. This is numeric data, which is really troublesome for the people to understand. Let us move directly to the heat map, which will give better understanding. So this is the correlation matrix heat map. One can see there are higher number of darker shades, which implies negative correlation. It is of majorly uniform color. Then outlier detection. Outliers detection I performed for each of the rows from V1, row columns V1 to V28. So one can see that outliers for fraud in V1 for fraudulent transaction are 174, and outliers in V1 for valid transaction are 691 to 6912. Similarly, for V2, the length for fraud transactions is 247, and for valid, it's 13,327. Similarly, it is calculated for V28. Then I have performed hypothesis testing. One can see the code here, where I have taken the alpha value very, really small, which implies higher accuracy. Now, one can see that for V1, there is an association between feature and the target variable. The target variable here is taken as class. And for no association, one can see that here, V13, there is no significant association between the feature and target variable. Now, I have performed subsampling, as one was not able to get much information out of the data set, much relevant information. So after subsampling, I have 984 rows and 31 columns with 492 fraud transactions and 492 valid transactions. Here, the percentage of fraud transactions is 50%, and the distribution of the classes in subsample data set is for 0, 0.5, and for 1, 0.5. Here is the correlation matrix of the very same subsample data set. One can see various colors. A mix of colors, where one is for lighter color is for positive correlation, and the darker shades are for negative correlation. The most important line is the last line here present, which I have represented individually to understand better. One can see that V17 here, V16, V14, V12, V10, and V3 are darker shades, which imply negative correlation. And the values, see, the ones who have higher negative value are fraud, which implies that negative correlation with higher negative values are frauds. Then the lighter shades, such as V11, V4, V2, and V19, show positive correlation. And here one can see that higher values are for frauds. Then I have performed the outlier detection for negative correlation. Since there are highly negative values, I have not removed them. And then I have performed the hypothesis on the subsample data set. And one can see where P2 has an association, P32 has an association. And the ones who don't have, there's V8 that has no significant association between the feature and the target variable. The point to note here is that the target variable still remains the class even after subsample data set. Then I have performed PC reduction to reduce the dimensionality. Then here one can see that the red dots are a fraud and the blue dots are for valid transaction. And further, I have performed TSNE, which shows two different, where the blue ones are for valid and red ones are for fraud. And the two visuals are completely different plots. So the conclusion, the original data set had really low fraud transactions, resulting in no strong correlation between class and other features. Subsampling really achieved balanced representation. The heat map showed varied positive and negative correlation, suggesting fraud detection potential. And using 10 top 10 negatively positively correlated features, scatter plots were generated using TSA and TSNE. The plots had distinct clusters for valid and fraud transaction, which indicated the potential for accurate fraud detection. Here are the references which I have taken help from. Thank you. For any questions, you can mail me on my email ID. Thank you, sir.
Are you taking any questions?
Yes, sir, I'm taking questions.
Okay. Can you go back to your code?
Yes, sir.
Right from the start.
Okay.
Scroll down, please. You can keep scrolling. Yeah, you can stop here. Up on the heat map. You mentioned that the class is like the important line over here. Can you tell me why it's important?
So it is really important because we are finding the correlation with the target variable as class.
Okay.
So we really need to know that how these features V1, V2, V3 are related with the class variable. Because our target variable is class, we want to know that how these features affect the value of the class of fraud and valid transaction.
Okay. And can you tell me why the target variable remains as the class even after subsampling?
Sir, because we really need to find the credit card fraud detection. And in credit card fraud detection, the class is the only variable which stands for the values for valid and fraud detection. 0 for valid and 1 for fraud detection. And the fraud values. Fraud transaction is denoted by 1 and 0 valid transaction is denoted by 0.
So like what exactly is happening over there? Like that I get, but I do not really understand why the target variable has been set as class only, even after subsampling. There could be a more technical explanation to it, right?
Sir, subsampling is just defined as when we take the data set with a large data set into small sample. Subsampling is defined as when there is a large data set containing huge number of values, and then we take a small sample containing equal number of values, which is not equal number of values. One may say that which that sample which is beneficial to us, or which is of more importance to us, which can really give us good insights into the data. So the target variable will remain the same no matter how deep we go into the data set or how small we perform on the data set. How much sum sampling, even after the subsample data set, if I again take a subsampling from the subsample data set, the target variable will still remain the same because my question is still, the problem statement is still the same, that I have to find the credit card fraud detection. And for that, the class is the only column which is containing the values for a fraud and valid transactions.
Okay, fair enough. You can scroll down again.
So that's the end.
No problem. You can come back to your presentation. Can you show me the references slide?
Yes, sir.
Okay. There was no problem with the presentation. The stories included were also fine as well. No issues over there. I think in the data exploration slide, you had, pasted paragraphs, I think, from the Kaggle data set. You have to mention bullet points over here.
Okay.
Other than that, yeah, the thank you and the Q&A slide, you have to split them up. The
okay.
Thank you slide has to come after the Q&A slide. Other than that, it was all fine. In this presentation, I did notice that I think you did properly refer to the past presentations and you did look at the videos as well, right?
Yes, sir.
Because the project was very, very similar to what I have also done and what another intern had also done. So what I would recommend is that I see, the thing about all of these tasks are just to, help you acquire, more exposure to all of the technologies and all of the concepts. But I hope that you have understood, but try to bring in something different again as well. Try not to stick to all of the presentations that have been uploaded on YouTube as well. Okay. Other than that, it was all fine. No problem at all. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you. Then we have Varun.
Hello, sir.
Okay. Yeah, Varun, you're audible. You have to turn on your camera first, Varun.
One second, sir. Am I visible, sir?
Not yet. Are you using two devices?
Yes, sir.
You do not have a camera on your main device?
No, sir. My webcam is not working, so I came from my mobile.
Okay, just a minute. Okay, yeah, you can start presenting.
Good evening. My name is Chintakindi Varun. I'm from Hyderabad, and my task is future location prediction using Data IQ. So in this presentation, I'm going to go through the contents first. So first, an introduction, literature review, and the flow of the project, final results and outputs, and conclusion. So first is project introduction. So what is future location prediction? Future location prediction is nothing but predicting where an entity or a person or an object is going to end up at a certain point of time in the future. So future location prediction is a technology that uses data analysis and machine learning algorithms to predict where the individuals or objects will be at a given point of time in the future. So this technology has numerous applications, from predicting traffic patterns to improving emergency responses, and it can also improve at the If there is an old person using this, they can know where they will be at a certain point of time in the future, from the starting point to the destination point. So why I use Data IQ? So Data IQ is a platform where for data professionals such as data scientists, data engineers, data analysts, and etc. So it has many features for data professionals, like exploring, manipulating the data easily, and showing analysis and making predictions and creating artificial intelligence models with easily, and it can be helpful for time saving and etc. So data IQ or DSS is a collaborative data science software from software platform for data professionals such as data scientists, data engineers, data analysts, data architectures, and etc. It is a centralized working environment that makes it easy to manipulate data, quickly explore and show analysis, and make predictions and create artificial intelligence models with a few just few clicks. So here, this is the data that has been provided to me from Hackweather Limited. So this is the location data set which has been provided, and the attributes of this data set are ID, event time start, event time and latitude start and longitude start, and latitude and longitude. So in this data set, this is the time starting point of the starting point of the time. And this is the end event time of the destination, and this is latitude start, and this is longitude start, where the starting point of the journey, and this is the latitude and longitude, and this is the end time of the journey. These are split. So if we combine these two, we'll get an exact point of the destination. So we're going to predict latitude and longitude. And I've done a comparative analysis, and I'll show you later in the presentation why I did latitude end separately and longitude end separately using different algorithms, and why what are the accuracies and what are the predictions that I've gotten from this. So let's start. So ensembling Bayesian technique. What is ensembling Bayesian technique? Is this ensembling Bayesian techniques acts as a background to minimize training errors, which will be occurring while performing the prediction. So boosting is an ensembling learning method that combines a set of weak learners into a strong learner to minimize training errors. So I'm predicting latitude and longitude and separately, so it is going to help me minimize the training errors that will be occurring in the training. So execution of the project. So I'm going to first predict latitude end by using lasso regression. So insert first, this will be the interface of the data IQ, and I'm going to insert the data set into the data IQ. And after inserting the data IQ, my flow will look like this. This is the data set that will be in my flow, and while interacting with it, it is going to grow like a tree, or it will grow like a flow chart while interacting with it. So after inserting the data set, what I'm going to do is I'm going to predict the latitude end using lasso regression. So why use lasso regression? I've done a comparative analysis. I'm going to tell you in the later in the presentation. So first I'm going to analyze the data set that has been given to me, and I'm going to select a target variable latitude end. Because we are predicting what is first we are predicting latitude end, so we are going to select the latitude end as a target variable. And after selecting the target variable, we are going to choose the algorithms, and after going to that, we are going to set the parameters for the prediction. So the parameters I'm going to select is training and testing set ratio will be 80 to 20, and the matrices will be R2 score will act as a background for this project, where it will minimize the errors that is going to occur in the evaluation. So after going to future handling, we are going to select the attributes on which basis the latitude end will be predicted. So we're going to select event time and latitude end and longitude end. We're not going to select ID because it is irrelevant, and it will affect our accuracy. So we are going to select event time start as well, and we're going to select the algorithm next. So after we are going to select lasso regression. I'm going to tell you why I use lasso regression in the later slides. So after applying the lasso regression algorithm, the results are the accuracy is very good, and this is a summary of the lasso regression. The training set is 1241 rows, and test set is 296 rows, and the train time is about a second. So in this, the artist score, this report summary, in the report summary, the artist score is very high. That is good because the accuracy is, the errors are very minimum, and the accuracy also very high. So in the matrices and assertions, we can see the error EVS is 100%, and the EAE is very minimum, and the mean absolute percentage error is also very minimum, and the mean squared error is also very minimum. So these are very minimum, and the R score is very high. That is good for the accuracy of the prediction. So after predicting the prediction of the destination latitude, now my flow will look like this after the prediction of the destination latitude. So now I'm going to take into consideration of these two inputs and create a new data set where the input where the prediction and errors are going to display. So I'm going to evaluate the model performance, and I'm going to input these two as my inputs, and I'm going to get in a new data set where it is called predicted latitude data set. So after the evaluation, my flow will look like this. So I've gotten two new data sets after evaluation of these two data set that we have gotten. And after that, the predicted latitude data set will look like this. So now we've gotten five new attributes, which is prediction, error, and this is the latitude and prediction that has been done, and this is the error which we have gotten from the prediction. So now the prediction, the predicted latitude matrices are very, EVS is very high, MAE is very low. So these are all very accurate, and the error is to the minimum. So now we have, since we have predicted the latitude, the end, we are going to predict the longitude and next. So now I'm going to predict the longitude and using the data set which I've got from the latitude. So now I'm why I'm using this predicted latitude data set, because the precision is very high and the accuracy is very good. Since I've gotten the much needed prediction, now I'm going to reuse this data set at my basis, and I'm going to predict the longitude n. So now setting the parameters for the prediction, training and set ratio is the same as the longitude and latitude, and it is 80 to 20. And the choosing the algorithm XGBoost, I've done the comparative analysis, so I'm going to let you know in the next slides. So feature handling. So why I use these all attributes, because ID is irrelevant. So these are all, using these bases, I'm going to predict the longitude and So result for the prediction of the XGBoost. So this is the results I've gotten from the prediction. So I've gotten very high prediction accuracy, and the training, this is a summary of it. The training set is 1241 rows, and the training set is 296 rows, and training time is about 2 seconds. And the metrics and assertions, we can see that EVS is very high, and the MAE is very low, and the absolute error is met to the minimum, and MSE is to the minimum as well, and the R2 score is very high. That is good. So now the final results and outputs. The prediction I've gotten is this row. This is the longitude end that I've predicted, and I've predicted longitude latitude end as well. So the final flow will look like this after the conclusion of the predicted latitude data set and the predicted longitude score and matrices. So first I've gotten this data set. After evaluating the data set, after analyzing the data set, I'm going to get a new data set, and after evaluating it, I'm going to get this data set while taking these two as inputs, And after getting the data set, I'm going to use this data set to get gain predicted longitude score as well. So comparative analysis by use lasso regression and XGBoost. So I'm going to prepare this data set using the existing data set. So I've just combined latitude start and longitude start, and I've gotten start destination. So this is the location. So this is the latitude and longitude, and after combining, I got end destination as well. So using that data set, I'm going to set the parameters for it too. I'm going to choose the algorithms. So this will be the algorithm that I'm going to select. I'm going to select every algorithm because this is a comparative analysis. So after comparing each and every algorithm, the accuracy of these algorithms are very low compared to lasso regression and XGBoost. So I'm going to use lasso regression. That's why I use lasso regression and lasso regression and XGBoost as my algorithms for the prediction. Thank you.
Are you taking questions?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Can we go back to this? Do you have a demonstration of this project?
Sir, I had yesterday, but the free trial ended, sir. So my account is suspended, so I couldn't demonstrate to
How did the free trial end?
you. While using the Data IQ, there are some paid tiers, so I couldn't use. I use them to create the demonstration. These are the screenshots I've taken from them as well. So I couldn't. This is not done in the free trial, so I had to do a paid.
Can you show me?
Yes, sir. My account has been suspended, so I can show you the email that I've gotten. Can you see it, sir? This as well on the
Can you log into your Amazon Web Services account?
Yes, sir. Exactly. Authentication failed because your account has been suspended. I've gotten a bill of 2,000 rupees for using this, so I couldn't pay it, so my account is suspended now.
Okay, no problem. But if you are facing any sort of technical issues like these, you should report to the technical support.
Okay, sir. Actually, my friend also got the 6,000 rupees of bills, sir. So we thought of asking, but we couldn't get a response from the support team.
What did they say?
Actually, my friend posted it, but he didn't get a response.
You could have asked yourself as well,
Yes,
right?
sir, but it happened recently, so I couldn't do it.
Was this yesterday?
No, sir. Actually, it has been 5 days, I guess, sir.
So you had enough time to ask.
Yes, sir, but I had scheduled this presentation before, sir. Like, had scheduled this a th on third, but I had to go out of some for emergency, so I couldn't have time for that.
Okay. Yeah, just present your presentation again.
Yes, sir.
Go to the fifth slide.
Yes, sir.
Can you explain why each what is exactly the correlation between each of these columns and why exactly I would we use all of these columns to predict the end destination?
Yes, sir. So this is the event time. So this ID is irrelevant because we can't predict anything with it. So event time start is a starting point of the to the destination. So this will be the starting time to the destination, and this will be the ending time of the destination. So this will be calculated because if an entity is going from place to place, there will be a starting point of the time, and there will be an end point of the time. So this is used to predict that. And latitude star is the starting point of the time. The starting point of the to the destination, and this is the longitude of the starting point. So this both will be combined, and this the location will be provided, and the latitude and the longitude as well. This is the latitude start and longitude and sorry latitude and longitude end. So these both will be combined, and it will give you a end destination.
Okay. Go to the next slide. Do you know anything about ensemble boosting or ensemble learning that you can tell me?
And what I know is it helps. It acts as a background for the project, and it will minimize the training errors which will occur in the performance of the prediction.
How does it minimize the errors?
So if I'm doing latitude and longitude and separately, so it will take into consideration, and it will minimize the errors while executing.
How? Do you know what ensemble learning is?
No, sir.
So not much research has been done, I think, because ensemble learning is simple, considering you have used so many algorithms all together. That's what ensemble learning is. Ensemble learning is combining all of those algorithms and then figuring out which exactly works best for you, or combining all of those algorithms in order to predict a certain value.
Yes, sir. That I've just got confused. So like, I've done research about it, but what I've gotten to the I've gotten conclusion that it will help in minimizing the training errors. So I can understand much better.
Go to the next slide. When you were comparing the algorithms, you did not talk about why lasso regression and SGBoost have been used. Can you tell me now? You just talked about the data set.
Yes, sir.
In that slide, you did not tell the actual reason why.
Because it is done in the background that I've done a comparative analysis on all the algorithms while using this data set. And after going through the analysis, the errors have been the accuracy is to the is almost same for every algorithm, but the errors that I've gotten is very high compared to lasso regression and XGBoost. So I've used lasso regression and XGBoost for the prediction.
Can you give me a basic definition of lasso regression and XGBoost?
So lasso regression hit I've done so here the lasso regression it is acts like a linear model for you know it reduces the problems of gaining the accuracy, and attributes using attributes using I've added a slide for lasso regression as well, so I might not have added it.
Please go to the start. Can you tell me how did you actually set up Data EQ?
I've logged into AWS.
Mm-hmm.
and I've created my account and I've inserted Data IQ in it while taking a server.
How?
I haven't added all this. I can show you the screenshot that I took. So here, I went to the AWS and I've created an I've logged into the account. I went to the EC2 and took an instance.
I can't see anything on your screen if you're presenting.
Okay, so 1 second, I am sure it is. Is it visible, sir? So I went to AWS and I've created an account. And after going to the account, I went to EC2, which will act as the server. And I took an instance from it. And I created an instance called Future Location Prediction. And after going to the instance, I will get an server. And then I took the server and I've logged into the Data IQ. And this is the server I used. So after going to the account, I inputted first data set. After inserting the data set, then I selected the data set as location data set and I created this data set.
Go back to your presentation. I asked you to give me the definitions of lasso regression and XGBoost. You did not talk about XGBoost. Do you know the definitions from top of your head? Or
I get confused, so that's why I can't.
you also mentioned in your presentation that the R2 score minimizes error. Do you think that statement was right?
Yes, sir, it acts as a hyperparameter optimization model. So it acts as a background for the evaluation model.
But how does it minimize error then? Do you know the answer or do you don't know the answer?
No, sir.
And what does an R2 score of 1 typically denote? No, if you don't know the answer, you can just say it because
No,
there
sir.
are other interns as well. So I don't think you have any sort of knowledge and you've just implemented the project just for the sake of it without actually researching about it thoroughly or learning the concepts. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
See, when you're part of an internship, we do not expect this from any of the interns. We do expect thorough research. The questions that I even asked you right now are simple. If you had researched thoroughly, you faced a technical issue 5 days ago, and I can understand if you had some sort of an emergency. If that was actually the case, if that was truly the case, then I can understand that you did not have enough time to research. But this is not really acceptable, Varun.
Yes, sir. Actually, I made it home yesterday, sir. I prepared the project like 2 weeks ago, and
Okay.
I made it home yesterday, so I couldn't prepare much. So I actually forgot, and I went back to my account, and it was suspended.
Okay.
So I had to make a presentation using my screenshots, sir. So I couldn't have the time for that, and I didn't use it. Yeah.
See, that is fine, but if there were technical issues, that is also fine. And considering you had an emergency, but next time, do your research, see what the concepts really are, try to understand them, because if this time, this is an exception, but if this keeps happening again, then
Yes, sir.
you will have very less scores.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. There was no did you include a reference slide?
No, sir.
There was I don't think there was a Q&A slide as well. So you have to include a reference slide and you have to also include a Q&A slide. And your Q&A slide is supposed to have an email ID along with it mentioned at the bottom. Okay. And thank you slide should come at the end. Other than that, you'll have to do better. You'll have to work hard. That is
Yes,
all
sir.
I can say.
Yes,
Yeah.
sir. Thank
Thank
you.
you. You can stop presenting. Then we have Darshan. Varun, you can stop sharing your screen. You can unmute.
Hello, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
Am I audible and visible?
Yeah, you're audible.
Thank you. So I have shared my screen. It will be visible, right?
Yeah, it's visible.
Yeah. So first of all, I'd like to thank you to present me here. My name is Darshan Vidwan. I am from Cybersecurity Internship Group. So today I will be presenting a denial of service attack using OWASP HTTP DOS2. So before starting this presentation, I might like asking question with the attendance. You have many of us are doing shopping daily, right? But before some time back, around 2018 or 19, many of us have faced like issues like that. When at the time of sale or something, just I take an example of like new phone is launched at this time. So if I like to buy a phone that time, but at the time of sale, just when I go to the Amazon or Flipkart, any other e-commerce shopping website, it shows the page can't be reached or the product might be out of stock just before we reach. That at that time, the service was not available for us. So we can assume that things like that the service there was a denial of service for us. So today's topic will be on that thing only. So we start from the table of contents. What is a DDoS attack? How DDoS attack work? Type of DDoS attack, famous DDoS attack, and prevention of DDoS. And after all that, we will see a small demo how DDoS attack work. So what is a DDoS attack? DDoS attack stands for distributed denial of service attack. Means if someone is accessing a website or something application, and at that particular time, that application or website is not available to that particular person or all the other people that are accessing that things. That is called distributed denial of service, means that service is not available. And this can be converted into attack by an attacker, which is called DDoS attack. What an their attacker do? An attacker send multiple requests to the server. Like for example, if I am an hacker and I send multiple requests to the hack with a page or website, and many of our interns are accessing that website or that our intern tracker, and it might be not available for all of us, then it can be assumed as that our hack with the website was attacked through a DDoS. So DDoS attack is majorly performed through botnets or some like malicious botnets, which are created through hacking many servers by an attacker. In the next slide, we will see how the DDoS attack works. So a DDoS attack is divided into two phases. In first phase, what does a hacker or attacker do? A hacker or attacker does hack some of the server devices or network devices, or he or she might create a zombie of network botnets. What that botnets do? That botnets will be sending multiple packets to the server or website, which will be crash for the user or might be unreachable. So in the first phase, a hacker will create a packet which we define as a zombie bot, which will be used later in the attack. In the next phase, what that the attacker will do, attacker will send these bots which create a flood of packets with continuous requests to the web server, which can cause the server system to crash or might be unavailable for that time. Many, many times, like recently, the UPI has introduced. So we are using Google Pay, Paytm, PhonePe, BharatPe, many financial applications are using. And many times we are experiencing the issue. Like the if we are sending the money to someone and we see that the server's bank, the receivers or senders bank servers is unreachable at the moment. What this caused? This cannot be an attack, but the bank servers which on the application is being hosted, that is not capable to handle this much of packets. So in next slide, we'll see how a DDoS attack works. What in the first and hacker is there. What he has hacked multiple devices out there, like it might be desktop, camera system, might be servers, and he has taken, maintained the logs and connection with all the hacked devices. And when the hacker attacker need to attack the server or some website or some application to crash that, what will we do? It will be sending a flood of packets. Packets can be termed and request. For example, if I take if a live video is going on and many of us can see that how many live persons have been watching of that video. So every person can be termed as a packet that the sharing that might be sending the packet on the YouTube video, and there you can see the how many people are seeing the live. This can be considered an example. And what next in next step, hackers have kept the or maintained the connection with the, all the hacked devices, and it send the flooded packets to the server or any web application, which cause an unreachability or unavailable of that page to the different users. This is how a DDoS attack works. So we will see different types of DDoS attacks here. So first attack is volumetric network-based attack. As I discussed in the last slide, volumetric, as the word defines, some might call volume will be there. These attacks focus on consuming all the bandwidth allocated to the server. A number of packets are being sent to the server, which cause a server might be unreachable or unavailable to that user. Volumetric network-based attack, what does it mean? Like I discussed first in the online sale example, like many of the users at a time are accessing an Amazon website, a Flipkart, or any other e-commerce website. And this server might not be capable or might not be configured to handle that much of requests. So this can be considered as a volume or network-based attack, but in positive way, not in negative way. So next type of attack is protocol-based attack. As many of us here are from technical backgrounds and we are seeing OSI layers or OSI model, there in the OSI layer, there are majorly seven layers. In the third and fourth layer, which is network and transport layer, on which this protocol-based attack work. There are majorly two protocols, TCP and UDP, Transmission Control Protocol and User Data Transfer Protocol. So this type of protocol works on the TCP base. What this attack do, protocol-based attack do, it is sends and synchronized. Here you can see and spoof SYN packet. SYN means synchronize and ACK means acknowledgement. What does a hacker will do? It will be continuously send synchronized packets to the server, and which a server have to respond, give acknowledgement, which these synchronized packets will be swoop, means which will be fake. This might not be a real traffic or something. This will be an attack to make the application slow down or it being crashed. So our next attack is application-based attack. Application-based attack is, as the name suggests, some might of application will be involved there. So if you are using WhatsApp or Facebook or something, Instagram, in the few past years, around 1 point, 1.5 around there, there was a news where Instagram was down for all the people all over the world or like particular countries. So this you can consider as an application-based attack. What does it do? And hacker send multiple requests to their application so that it might be not available for the users at that time. In our many of us are daily using the WhatsApp, and in the WhatsApp forwards also we are receiving a single type of some type of message that cause a lag to our phone sometime or to our WhatsApp also. This might you can consider as an application-based attack, but at very minimum level. That the message, what does it do? It has huge amount of text in it, which the WhatsApp or the phone was not capable at that time handling that message. So it might cause a crash or lag to a WhatsApp. So these were the types of DDoS attacks. So in the next, we will see famous DDoS attacks around the world. So this is the most recent DDoS attack which were done on the Indian airports and health institutions. Indian airports were of the major metro cities as Bangalore, Delhi, Mumbai, and Kerala. And this attack lasts for the 8 hours. You can think these airports websites and health institution websites were down for long 8 hours. Like how much loss this institution and business have faced. Around April 8th, the attack was started by a Sudan group, which the information was received by a Telegram group. And as the attack started, the company, the cybersecurity service provider of these airports and health institutions, got an alert at the time of these attacks, and they were very early to mitigate this. And in the 8 hours, but then also it took 8 hours to mitigate these attacks. Next is in September 2020, attack was an NPCI. NPCI, as many of us, it is a National Payment Corporation of India, which all powers away on all of the UPI payments and NEFT and all the things. And this attack on the NPCI was the major cause to do was to stop the transactions being done by the NPCI. And the next attack was done on the Amazon Web Service in the February. It was an packet flood attacks in which the packet speed was 1.34 TB, 1.34 terabytes per seconds. That much of packets were sending to the AWS cloud, which caused a downtime for last 20 minutes only. AWS were using an antivirus protection service, which caused give them an alert, and the attack only caused the last 20 minutes. Next, the February 2018 GitHub. As all of our developers are using GitHub as their primary tool to share code or between their team or their friends, it was also attacked in the 2018. The February 2018 GitHub attack, I will be explaining it in the next slide, that how the attack was there. And another attack was September 2017, which was done on Google. This attack is the largest attack yet, which was done on the Google. As I discussed last, the attack which was done on AWS speed was 1.54 TB per second around. And on Google, the packets per second which was sent about 2.54 TB, which caused Google a lot. And this attack also lasts for around 1 hour. But Google was early to recover back from it. As I discussed in last, this was the GitHub which was hit by 1.36 terabytes per second. It was lasted for 20 minutes. So you can see there is a normal timeline below, which there's a difference between normal traffic and the after DDoS traffic. You can see a certain spike in the traffic, which was around 1.35 TB. Terabyte speed per second where the packet was sent, which will cause a application to slow down for that time. So what in to say from this attack, there are some methods through which we can prevention of DDoS attacks. So first is empty employee load balancers and firewalls. Employee load balancers. As the load balancers were determined, there might be something balancing technology might be used. And firewall, many of us might be used to with the firewall. I will explain about that also. Employee load balancer. What does load balancer do? If I am like I am hosting an Amazon like website, and I have like currently we saw the Freedom sale, and I assume that there might be 1 million traffic will be coming to my website or application. So what I will do, I will employ load balancer. Load balancer, what will be doing? It will be balancing the traffic to multiple servers hosted by the Amazon. So the 1 million people will be divided into 10 lakh, and it will be deployed on the all the servers. So it will not cause the application to crash or slow down. And firewalls, what does it do? Firewall is a security hardware device, and it can be deployed as a software also, but majorly an hardware device which monitors the incoming and outgoing traffic of an institution, of a system. So firewall, what does a firewall will help? Firewall will block the IPs that are sending multiple packets at a single time. There are certain IP rules are set in the servers which will help the firewall to block a particular IP. So next is a next type of prevention is like this: detect and attack early and mitigate the damage beyond that point. What this says that like there are many industry-based tools like where web page or server is monitored 24 by 7. And there are certain set of rules that are configured for these things. So if end tool is saying that a particular IP is sending this much of packets, though, so this will be like, this might be something different, and this will raise an alert to the analyst. An analyst will stop the attack and mitigate the damage beyond that point. So next is a solution. Like many of us have been switched today to the AWS, Azure, and cloud platforms like Amazon Web Service, Azure by Microsoft, and Google Cloud Platform. This cloud platform have an advantage that local web hosting provider doesn't have. What does it do? This gives an option of implementing some configuration policies so that if our website or web server is experiencing some kind of unexperienced traffic or some packets, so this cloud service configure policies automatically block them and will be using normal to the normal users. And the next is by allocating more bandwidth to the server. This allocating more bandwidth, what does it mean? Like, for example, I talked in the before slide that load balancing thing. If there is sale and I will be experiencing 1 million people on my site. So there is some particular bandwidth. What does it mean bandwidth here? Like many of us are using like internet of connections of home in mobile data, we got 1.5 GB per day. Like that is our bandwidth to allow that much of amount of data. And there is a bandwidth that we can configure in the server for the maximum user. What does bandwidth do? Bandwidth will help the user to send and receive data in very smoother way. The bandwidth is allowed more. Like if we get more amount of data, like we can use more access the internet and download the things. Same like thing goes with the server. If a server is allowed more, allow it some more bandwidth, so it will prevent from the clogging of data of the sent and receiving requests. So these are some open source DDoS mitigation tools. Mitigation, what does it mean? Mitigation means it helps to prevent from the DDoS attack. Here is an OWASP HTTP host. OWASP means Open Web Application Security Protocols. HTTP, Hypertext Transfer Protocol, host. It is a tool, open source tool, which is helping us to prevent from a DDoS attack. Today, in our live demo, I will be showing HTTP, OWASP HTTP DOS tool, which will be helping, which will be with, through which we will be performing the DOS attack. So next is an Nginx. Many of us have been heard about this Nginx. Nginx, what does it do? It provides an anti-DDoS service on a cloud platforms and website. So if Nginx is deployed on our website, on a web server, it will be automatically detecting the surge of the traffic and block that particular IPs. Next is HAProxy. HAProxy is also the same that the Nginx do. HAProxy blocks that type of proxies or IP addresses that is sending the floods of packet on the devices. And next is DDoS deflate. As the name suggests, DDoS deflate. Deflate means to take down something or reduce something from a particular thing. What does it? It is an open source tool which is deployed on the web server or an internet app, the servers server, it can be called a server system where the DDoS deflate will be monitoring all the things, mm-hmm. and it will give us an alerts and notifications that this IP might cause an attack or something that on that we can mitigate that. So here we'll be seeing the live demo how a DDoS attack works. First of all, before starting, I was to give an overview what we'll be seeing next. Here, I have set up an Amazon AWS server of Kali Linux on which I will be hosting a web page where I will be using an HTTP OWASP HTTP DOS tool, which the tool will be used to perform the DDoS attack. So here we'll be starting our live demo. So first of all, I have logged into my Amazon web server. Now I am starting my instance. So the server is starting. So our server has started. Let me show you the next step. I will be copying my public IP address. Next, I will be using the footage to connect to my web server. So I will paste my IP address. Next, I will be using the public key file, which has authorization, which I have stored before only. I will be using a Kali. I am using Kali image on the AWS. So I will be inserting my passphrase next. So here our server has been started. So first step, what I will be doing, I'll be starting my web server Apache on which the web page will be running. So I will be running as a this and in the admin position so that all the privileges can be accessed. So here you can see my web page has been started. So here we will pay, I will paste my IP address. You can see my IP address, which we got from the AWS server, it is been live. So back to our instances. Next, what we'll be doing, I will be using Netcat. Netcat, what will be doing, it will be listening on the particular port the traffic will be coming. So I will be using a Netcat command. I will be keep alive verbose, which means the, to listen, and I will declare a port. I will be declaring the port 44 on which I will be listening to all my traffic here. So our server has been ready. Now what I will do, I will start my DDoS attack tool. It is a desktop application based tool which I will be starting. So coming on to this, here we will there are three type of attacks in this: slow header, slow post, SSL renegation. So here we will be using the slow headers attack, where I will be pasting my IP address with the URL. So this is my IP address. Okay. Next, the port I have defined here, 4444. So here, next, coming to the next options, here are general parameters in which connections, connection rate, timeout, and user agent. Connections, it is saying that how many connections you have to send, and connection rate, how many connections you have to send at a particular time. So I will be doing like 4000 connections and like 400 connections at a time, and timeout might be 1000 seconds. And user agent, what does a user agent do? User agent, what does it be showing? That it is not coming in particular IP address, it is by accessing from a particular system. So here all of my setup is done, and you can see in the my Kali command line interface, this Netcat is listening. Netcat is listening on the port of 4444, and I will be running my attack here. See, the servers is getting the request now, and how much the request has been sent till yet. The request has been sending and sending, and our server has been configured that it can be accept only 100 requests at a particular time. So you can see as I'm reloading the page, at least taking time to reload. Why? Because we are performing a DDoS attack at current live. So as you can see, our DDoS attack has been started, but our server was configured for to accept only a few hundred connections. So here you can see active connections are 101 and connected are 100. So as the time passes, the connections will be getting lesser by lesser. See, from 100, 101 for 200, it will be getting lesser and lesser. So this was a DDoS attack example. So how does a DDoS attack work? So I mean canceling the attack for now. And back to my console. So here we saw that how the DDoS attack works. But if, like, we assume we are a working company and we have given tasks to prevent our server from by attacking a DDoS attack. So what will we do? For a server, there are some configurations in on which there is an IP tables where all the rules are stored for some type of policy which can create for a particular server web application through which it will be accepting particular request at a particular time. So here you can see new connection denied, connection limit lead 100. So what I will do, I will listening again, and this time I will be sending on 99 requests, and I'll be sending it by 10 by 10 and be 100 seconds. So I'll be running the attack. So you can see the 99 attacks we are coming, and the active and connections are same. So you can here you can see the active and connected attacks which we have done by us. As I told before, our server is currently configured to accept only 100 requests. So you can see the request has been came, and as I told before, the user agent Mozilla MSI Windows NT5 Trident. So I'm canceling my attack again. So what I'll be doing here, I'll be giving a rule to our IP tables, which means a policy which is already there by default. And here I will be configuring that it should accept only 5 requests from a particular IP address. So suppose, for example, in our organization, there are around 1,000 to 2,000 people, and they are accessing their company online website on which all the functions of the company is going on. So what I will be doing, I will be doing that a particular IP should send only 5 requests at a time, so that it might not crash the server. So what I'll be do, I will go with the admin commands here. Admin privileges sudo IP tables. It is a command A. First of all, I show you the list on which all the IP tables are there. How many IP tables are there? Currently, you can see there are only 3 rules, like which are there for accepting all the type of as the default 100 requests at a time. So we'll be defining a new request. First of all, I configure back to listening. Then A means to add a new IP table. P means which protocol, as we discussed before. which type of protocol you have to use, TCP or UDP. Here the protocol will be using TCP and we'll be using D port. What does D port mean? D port means destination port. Destination port means on which port the particular the application or system or server is working. So I have configured my server for the 444 port. So I define. So I will be using an AR rule. M minus M. What will be do? It will be doing connection limit. Connection limit is an example. What the connection limit will do? Connection limit if it stops if the connection goes above that. So connection limit and pi. What does it mean? Pi means if above the pi connections are there from a particular IP, that will be rejected. So I just press here enter. So I will be again in listing on my server. We'll be sharing all again the attacks. So here I'll be doing 10 connections to show and one connection rate, and I will be running the attack. So you can see they're coming. As you can see, as the five attack came, there are only five only connected, but active there are 10. That means above the five attacks, it were rejected. So this was a very much basic example that how to mitigate and DDoS attack. And next you can see another five attacks are disconnected currently because of our IP table rule. So here we will again back to work and we will see how many IP tables are listed currently now. As you can see, before they were showing only 3, and currently we have added which target reject more than 5. Okay. So this is our live demo. So moving on to conclusion. Today also DDoS attack is a very majorly attack. Currently also many of the websites are being attacked with this attack. So it is a persistent evolving threat. So to minimize this thing, an organization have to make strategies to mitigate the DDoS attack. So here I am done with my slide. So we can start taking any questions. So please, anyone have any questions, please go ahead. I think nobody have any questions. So thank you.
Great presentation, thoroughly researched. Are you what year are you in?
Actually, I have completed my master's last year in computer applications.
Okay. So
and
you're trying to explore the cybersecurity domain.
Yes, actually, I'm currently a working professional, but I'm taking my time to.
Okay,
explore.
Okay. That's great. Yeah. That's great. The presentation was really nice. I have no issues with it. Can you go back? Can you just show me the entire presentation once again?
Yes.
I'll just check if I have to give any extra suggestions.
Yes, sure.
Because other than that, it was perfect. Yeah, no suggestions at all. This is one of the presentations that I would definitely recommend to other interns as well.
Thank
Perfectly
you.
Done. You can stop presenting. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'll also send a review to you on your email ID. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Then we have Snehanjali. You can unmute. Yeah, you're audible.
Thank you. Myself, Mitta Snehanil sir. I'm from Artificial Intelligence Group. I'm here to deliver a presentation based on my first task. My first task is about my fitness plan. Let's get started. Many people in the world, now we are facing to gain
Nehanjali,
calories or
I
lose
think you're
calories.
having network issues because I can't really hear you properly.
Can I deliver tomorrow, sir?
Yeah, no problem. But do deliver
Okay, sir.
tomorrow,
Thank
okay?
you, sir. Okay, sir.
Yeah. You can stop presenting. Aman, are you ready with your presentation?
Yes, sir. Sir, I'm that I have missed some of the topics. A few topics.
What few topics? What is your
My
project
topic
name?
Was AWS EC2.
Okay.
Linux.
Okay. So you do not want to present today?
I can give it tomorrow, sir, if you say.
Okay, no problem. So you and
because some of the topics I have left out. I don't want to miss that topic because that's the main one.
Okay. Sure. No problem. You can present tomorrow as well. Then I don't think we have any other interns to give the presentation today. So I'll stop the recording. Thank you everyone for joining in.
Okay, sir. Thank you.